Thank you for joining the Ones Changing the World, which is India's first future tech meets sustainability podcast. And today I'm delighted and honored to have with me Dr. Raghunath Anand Mashelkar, one of India's most eminent scientists. He's the brain behind inclusive innovation, more from less for more, and Gandhian Engineering. Dr. Mashelkar has actively served the government of India by chairing 16 highly empowered Mashelkar committees and has been a member of the Scientific Advisory Council to the Prime Minister. His contributions to the nation and to science at large have been honored by a plethora of awards, the most significant being the Padma Vibhushan, the Padma Bhushan, the Padma Shri. He is the third Indian engineer to be inducted as a fellow of the Royal Society UK and the first Indian to be elected as a fellow of National Academy of Inventors US. Currently, Dr. Mashelkar is the president of the Global Research Alliance, chairperson of the National Innovation Foundation of India, and serves on boards of many leading companies. So, Doctor, it's a complete pleasure and honor to have you on the podcast. You have had a fantastical journey, you know, and the best part is, you know, I was going through your website and it seems you came from like a very lower middle class family. And your website also said that you studied under street lamps. And you know, the journey from there to becoming a global change maker, I would love you to share that and possibly life lessons which you would want to share with the audience.
Thank you very much, Eddie. First of all, it's a great honor, great privilege to be in conversation with you. I've seen the series of podcasts that you have done. They're absolutely outstanding, and it is nice to be counted amongst your podcasters. I think the first and foremost, since you asked about the fact that I came up from humble beginnings, I think the first principle that I learned is that to whom you are born, where you are born, on what day you are born, under what conditions you are born, is not in your hand at all. But what you do with yourself, how you build your destiny, is in your hands. So I think that's the first lesson that I learned. The second lesson is about a powerful equation that I learned. And there is an interesting story about it. There was a discussion on what is the most powerful equation that scientists have developed. So somebody got up and said, you know, Newton's law, force equal to mass into acceleration, F equal to M. Somebody got up and said, no, it is Einstein, E equal to MC squared, you know. Then I was keeping quiet, and then they came to me and said, but you have not said anything. I said, not Newton, not Einstein. The most powerful equation is E equal to F. So they wondered, what is E, what is F? I said, E is education and F is future. Education is equal to future. That's the biggest lesson that I learned. I had access to education. Now you would say, because you are a scientist, you can't just propose an equation, you have to prove it. So I will prove it. And there are several proofs. The fact that you are interviewing me itself is a proof, having come from some humble background. And they were real humble. They're not lower middle class family at all. They were not poverty. They were extreme poverty. I was born in a village called Mashel. My father died when I was 6. My mother could hardly read or write. She brought me to Mumbai. She did many jobs to bring me up. 2 meals a day was a challenge. I studied under streetlights. Yes, that is true. I walked barefoot until I was 12. And there, it was a big, big, big struggle. And having got that, I think the breakthrough came when I got a Tata scholarship of 60 rupees per month, which is less than $1 a month. And that was for 6 years, and that's how I could study. But the interesting part on the proof of that equation is given on 30th of March 2000, where in Rashtrapati Bhavan, that is where the Indian president resides, there was a celebration in terms of national honors, and the national honor of Padma Bhushan was given. By whom? By K.R. Narayanan, who was then the president. To whom? To me and Ratan Tata. Now, how does that prove the equation? K. Narayanan himself was born in a very poor family, walked 10 to 11 kilometers every day, back and forth. And his father and mother were so poor that they could not afford his tuition fee. So he would stand outside the class and take notes, okay? But he got a breakthrough because he got a Tata scholarship and went on to become the president. I got a breakthrough because I got a Tata scholarship and went on to. And the most interesting thing is that one Tata scholar gave Padma Bhushan honor to another Tata scholar, but at the same time he gave it to Ratan Tata, who was the head of the family of Tatas. Now you can just quite clearly see the power of education. Because of the power of education, K. R. Narayanan was where he was. Because of power of education, I was where I was. So I think the second lesson I have learned is the power of education. And that is why I always tell the government that you have to have three priorities. Your priority number one is education, priority number two is education, and priority number three is education. I would say that these are sort of the critical lesson that I've got. Of course, it is education plus opportunity. It is not just education, as we sort of all know. So I will just summarize by saying that education also gives you the confidence to deal with the world. And that also tells you that there are no limits to what you can achieve, excepting the limits you put on sort of yourself. But the third lesson and the fourth lesson, I would say, because I have grown all along in scarcity, whether I was studying or whether I was doing my research, etc. I did my research in poor India, not the India of today. There was a scarcity. But if you combine scarcity with aspirations, it's a deadly combination. So these are the four lessons.
There are a lot of people who complain that, oh, I don't have this, and if I had this, I could have done that. And we, I think, waste our time in complaining that, oh, we don't have this and we don't have that. But, you know, the ones who want to do it, I think they don't let anything stop themselves. And I think that the word impossible itself, I mean, you know, it's the mindset. If you kind of break down the spelling of it, you know, and you it depends upon your perspective. Like I used to earlier call this podcast I Am Possible, because it's the way you see things. You know, if you do not get constrained by boundaries, by where you are or what you are and where you come from, and you want to go beyond, I think, you know, you can like really go beyond. And you rightfully pointed out, yeah, the equation E equal to F, education equal to future. I think that's the core. Today, I think the internet is full of education. You know, there's so much education. You know, you could be sitting in a rural area or a urban area. You know, there's something called as massive open online courses, which is MOOCs, which is education available for free. And I firmly believe that the only thing that stops oneself is the desire and intent. Because if you have the desire and intent and the curiosity to learn more, the internet is there. It's a teacher, and anybody and everybody can, you know, be what he or she wants to be, you know, because we're living in a fantastic world. So thank you for sharing your journey. Now, when I shared your introduction, I mean, I gave like a very brief introduction, but you know, you have had such a colorful, past. In fact, even the present also, you're doing some wonderful, wonderful things. Would you like to briefly kind of highlight your career, and what's the next big problem that you're working on solving?
Well, I was trained as a chemical engineer. I did my bachelor's degree in chemical engineering in an institute called UDCT, University Department of Chemical Technology, which has become now an autonomous institution called Institute of Chemical Technology. It has a university status, not that of a department, but a university. And I'm very proud to say that I'm an alumnus of that university and also the chancellor of that university for the last 9 years. And I feel great about it. I did my PhD also in chemical engineering there. I was abroad, had a brief stint, and came back under very interesting circumstances. Because at that time, brain drain was very common. You went abroad and you never came back. And I came back at the age of 32, where I was doing a sort of outstandingly well there. And that itself is an interesting story. I remember the then Director General of CSIR, Council of Scientific Industrial Research, Dr. Nayaduma had come to London. And I got a message from Dr. B.D. Chirk of NCL that I should go and see him. He didn't tell me why I should see him, but he was my guru. I said, you listen to the guru, I went. And honestly, Eddie, when I went, I did not know that I'm going to commit, that I will leave everything from there and come back to India at the age of 32. Because Dr. Nayaduma actually portrayed the picture of India, and he said, when you become very old, you will come. But young, now you come back and build India, you know. And, you know, I don't think from here, Eddie, I think from here. I instantly said yes, you know. And called Vaishali, my wife, in the evening, and she, of course, has been all support. She said, let's go back. And I came under very difficult circumstances, 76. We were not $2,000 GDP per capita. We were $100 GDP per capita. And therefore, it was a big struggle to do sort of research. But we built world-class polymer science engineering group. I became the director of National Chemical Laboratory and then became the director general of CSIR, which is a chain of 40 laboratories, national laboratories, like National Chemical Laboratory, National Physical Laboratory, National Aeronautical Laboratory, etc. And I was the longest serving director general of CSIR. And I'm very proud to say that CSIR transformed itself during the time I was the director general. And Professor Jain Narlikar, in his book, Scientific Age, has listed the top 10 achievements of Indian science technology in the 20th century, starting with Ramanujan and Raman and Green Revolution and so on. And the 10th achievement is the CSIR transformation. So it was kind of leadership at a laboratory level, leadership at a national level. That was my journey. And later on, I became the president of Global Research Alliance, which is not just CSIR of India, but CSIR Australia, CSIR South Africa, Frankfurt Alps of Germany, BTT Finland, BTI Denmark, PNA Netherlands, Battelle USA, etc., etc. So this has been my sort of career path. Now, a very important question that you ask, what is it that you are sort of up to, and what is the big challenge? I believe that there are two big challenges that face the world today. The first is, of course, climate change, and the future is something that we need to really worry about. And that is where all the talk of green energy and green hydrogen and the rest of it, and we'll come back to that later. So that is occupying my attention in some form, and I will tell you about that later. But the other thing that is occupying my attention is inequalities. There are huge inequalities that are a big challenge before the world. The rich have got richer, but the poor have got poorer. And pandemic has made the sort of situation worse, because those who are poor have become extremely poor, all right? Hundreds and millions of them. And India is absolutely no exception to that. So the challenge, therefore, is that whatever work we have done to reduce poverty for, let's say, 10 to 15 years, have just vanished within 10 to 15 months, I would say. And we are back to square one. So how do you actually reduce these inequalities again? We again can't take 10 to 15 years. We have to do it fast. So it is not growth. It is inclusive growth. And it is not inclusive growth. It is accelerated inclusive growth. And for that, my mantra is inclusive innovation. What is inclusive innovation? I defined it as Gandhian engineering at a point in time. You know, Mahatma Gandhi had said that there is enough for everyone's need, but not for everyone's greed. Or in other words, he had said, use the resources very carefully so that you can keep them for the next generation and the following generation and the following. That is, getting more from less. And then he had also said, take the benefits of science to the poorest of the poor. All right. That means getting it for more and more people. So it becomes more from less for more. All right. That became the mantra. That became the Gandhian engineering. And that I've been pursuing relentlessly. I've talked about it in almost 50 cities of the world, by the way, during the last 10 to 12 years. I uttered the world's Gandhian Engineering for the first time in 2008 in Australia, where I was honored with a fellowship. And that means it is giving access equality despite income inequality. You know, just to give you an example, you will see now, I mean, on the other day I was walking on the road and I saw a woman cleaning the streets with a broom with one hand, but on the other hand, she had a mobile. Okay, that is, despite being poor, so poor, she has access. So how do you make high technology work for the poor? That is my sort of objective, and that is my big project. That is where I have created, in my mother's name, Anjali Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Awards, basically, where we create what is called affordable excellence. Normally, affordability and excellence don't go together, but it is all about making high technology work for the poor. So, summarizing, these are the two challenges. Climate change, I'm involved in that, and increasing inequalities, I'm involved.
Lovely, lovely. Both are such huge problems. And obviously, I mean, I want to get into the climate change part, you know, in depth, and talk about your involvement in it, you know, and how you're working, you know, with the green hydrogen space. But coming back to, I mean, to inequalities, you know, because you stressed on that. And I think it's globally, I think it's eating up, you know, I mean, the entire world, you know, it's not just in India, you know, the inequality is like really, really growing, you know. And I think you rightfully pointed out, it's getting more and more evident, because, you know, there's those haves who've got everything and there's have-nots who don't have even the basics, you know. How do we kind of overcome the challenge? It's a global challenge, which I think, you know, everybody needs to come together and try to find a constructive solution, because technology today, I think it's growing rapidly, and I think in the next few possibly decades, it's going to create huge and humongous impacts. You know, it's going to completely upend the education industry, possibly democratize education industry, the healthcare industry, the training, and the list is pretty much you know, endless of the benefits that the technology is going to do. But on the other side is also that, you know, the scary side of automation. You know, where like artificial intelligence and autonomous vehicles, you know, could possibly, you know, create deep impact, you know, with automation, you know, maybe in the next possibly 30 to 30 years, those truck drivers, starting with America, because obviously it's going to hit over there, it's going to hit India after a certain point of time. You know, those truck drivers are going to lose jobs. There are, you know, jobs like the banking industry, the guy kind of, the people who kind of feed in you know, information, they're going to lose job because of automation, and the list is pretty much endless. And so this, the way it's going to impact that inequality which is already there, and with the tech, I think it's going to create more, the inequality is going to get more evident, because the ones who understand tech or who have been invested in that are going to grow more prosperous, and the ones who don't understand are going to be left out. How do we solve this challenge? What's the roadmap or what's the plan over there to address this huge, huge problem?
I think the important part, Eddie, to remember is that the technological change is not something that is new. It has been happening all over the years, as a matter of fact. And the major difference is in terms of the exponential technology. And by exponential technology, I mean the performance is increasing exponentially, the prices are dropping exponentially, and the change is taking at exponential speed, 1, 2, 3. That is the major difference, as a matter of fact, all right? The second thing is that history shows that when technology takes away the old jobs, it creates new jobs. All right? Like the banking industry that you talked about, there are new jobs that are being created. In fact, I remember the former education minister, Prakash Javadekar, had come home for a cup of tea, I remember about 4 or 5 years ago. And at that time, I gave him a list of 55 new jobs that are going to come because of the exponential technology, comprising big data analytics, artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, Internet of Things, blockchain, and what have you, all right? So therefore, what is important now is upskilling people in those areas. That is going to be the key. The third is, I would say, Indian phenomenon that you are seeing now in terms of digital India actually shows you how the digitalization and technology is helping. For example, you look at what was called as JAM, Jandan Yojana, Aadhaar, and mobile. Okay. Now, Jandan Yojana was a policy. Aadhaar was that identity card, individual identity card, and M was mobile. Okay. The combination of the three created bank accounts for the poorest of the poor, and we have a Guinness Book of Record having done it in the fastest possible way. So close to 400 million accounts have been created in the record time. And you can quite clearly see this is bringing empowerment because the money goes directly in wife's account, in a poor housewife's account. When pandemic came, for example, the help reached the poor almost immediately. And that was transformational. Look at the other end, the startups, for example. Okay. Now, what is the issue of startup? You have something called unicorn. Unicorn is a market cap of $1 billion, as you know. India, until 2019, was having one unicorn per year. In 2021, it had 44 unicorns. It means from almost one unicorn per week. From one unicorn per year to one unicorn per week. Why? Because of digital access, basically. You know, this was transformational. Because what happened was, as far as software is concerned, it became open source software. You didn't have to depend on the Windows of this world. As far as storage was concerned, there was cloud, very affordable. And as far as data was concerned, thanks to Jio, mobile internet, if you look at 4 rupees per Jio, 4 rupees per GB, and voice free. So therefore, I have done an analysis of the 116 unicorns that have come up. Can you just believe it, Eddie? Half of them, close to half of them, come from tier 3 cities, tier 2 cities, and dropouts. Could you imagine that somebody from the interior, from a tier 3 city, a 27, 28 year old, having a market cap of $1 billion coming from there? So it has two sides. If you provide access, basically, you can create miracles of the kind that I basically talked about. So people call me a dangerous optimist. I'm very optimistic about the very positive use of these technologies.
I mean, I would like to correct myself or possibly maybe, reaffirm that, through all my podcasts, I keep on saying the technology itself is never good or bad. It's the way we choose to use it, where we choose to use it and how what the output will definitely be the output. So yes, I mean, technology is a great, great tool. It is going to create automation. It's going to, create a lot of job loss. But yes, it's also going to create new jobs, and for that, reskilling and upskilling is such a need. And you also pointed out, because of the digital access, and I think the listeners should take this, that those 44 unicorns out of 2021, you said most of them came from tier 2, tier 3 cities, and some of them were dropouts. So that's so wonderful that our ecosystem in India is flourishing. We are creating things out of the most expected places, and that's surprising. And I'm extremely proud that, there are so many great things happening in India. Now, the education system, you mentioned about the education is equal to future. That was the equation. Now, I completely double that. But somehow India's education system is still seems to be caught up in the rote education learning, while most of the startups are saying that we are not looking at degrees, we are looking at skills. There's entrepreneurs such as Elon Musk and so many others who are saying that what is important is skills. But somehow a mindset of parents still push to, you know, our students towards a traditional, okay, you need to be a doctor, you need to be this, wherein the world has completely changed. You rightfully pointed out that there's so many jobs of these, you know, data science, augmented reality, virtual reality, blockchain, and so on and so forth. How do we create an education which is tuned into the future? How do we create a narrative or make the future understand, the next gen understand the benefits of, you know, upskilling, being in tune with the future, leveraging augmented reality, virtual reality, metaverse, and also a traditional, not missing out, you know, not just going extreme towards the technology, but leveraging the both to create a better. What would be your suggestions on that?
Yes, I think this is a very, very important question, because if education is future, let us just focus on education. There are three things of education. The first is right to education. The second is right way of education. And third is right education. Let me explain each one of them. Right to education. You know, we had this in 2002, we launched this Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, which means every child must get access to education, which is wonderful. Okay. But now what has happened is that during pandemic, 100 million children went out of school in 100 days. And then you had that digital deprivation where one third of them did not have digital access. Right? So right to education has become digital right to education. That means every child must be empowered. You know, like I said, Tata's gave me 60 rupees per month and that was fine. In the old days. But if they give me 60 rupees per month, but I don't have digital access, I will not have access to education. That's the first. The second point is right way of education. Right way education is not going to be just digital education. It's not going to be just physical education. It's going to be digital education. That means part physical and part digital. Why do I say that? Education is, after all, learning, doing, and being. Learning, you can partly do through the digital access. You talked about so many courses and this thing, etc., on the internet. Fine. But there is a doing part of it, doing by your hand. You can't substitute that. And there is a being part of it, being a part of the society, being a human. After all, education is all about creating sort of a human with empathy, for example, emotional intelligence, left brain and right brain, whole brain, and so on and so forth, being a part of the society, and that requires social interactions. So it cannot be digital, it cannot be physical. It is going to be astute mix of that. All right. So I talked about right to education. I talked about right way of education, where pedagogies have to change now. It is not learning by rote, but learning by doing. It's not learning by doing, like what teacher tells you, step 1, 2, 3, 4, but learning by creating yourself. And it's not just learning by creating, it is learning by co-creating. We have to learn. It is not man versus machine. It is man and machine. It's not robots. It is cobots. You get my point. So therefore, learning by rote to learning by doing to learning by creating to learning by co-creating. I think that's basically the issue. And experiential learning is a very important sort of a part of it. These are the fundamental changes that we have to have. And most importantly, finally, education has to be for problem solving. Okay? We have to teach students not to be a part of a problem, but part of a solution. In fact, I am on the Queen Elizabeth Prize of Engineering, which is £1 million prize, which is a Nobel Prize in engineering. And they had interviewed me, what branch of engineering do you think will be most important? Electrical, mechanical, chemical, and so on. Then I got on their board. And I remember I said, none of that. Solution engineer. All right. So we have to create solution engineers that given problem, anything in the society with regard to climate, with regard to whatever sort of you have pollution or the social conflict or whatever, how do you sort of find solution? So these are actually the changes that we must basically realize, not going to the extremes, as you rightly pointed out, but a good blend of the two. That's what is going to be the thing.
you have been the Director General for CSIR. What do you see the role of science, technology to creating a better India? And especially, I mean, you know, there seems to be like a low support, you know, when it comes to deep tech investment, you know. But if you see like nations like America and China, the reason they have become these global tech superpowers is because they foster innovation. And if we believe that innovation is the key to our future, that means, you know, we need to support our deep tech. What do you think can be done to change that and push that ecosystem?
Yes, I would say that if you look at the digital transformation of India itself, deep tech has played a very major role in that particular transformation. And see, for example, on 21st July, you know, there is what is called as a Geo Institute. I happen to be chancellor, and we are starting master's degree courses on big data analytics and artificial intelligence, as well as digital marketing digital media and marketing communications, for example. We are looking at sort of creating a sort of deep tech manpower, and that is so sort of across the country. So that definitely is happening. We are not doing with as much speed as, for example, China. I must admit that. For example, AI is taught there to the school children, basically, you know, school going children. I think we need to sort of develop that. That's number one. Number two, as far as your fundamental question in terms of the role of science, technology, and innovation in building a better India, I think we could not have got a better answer than during the pandemic. Because 2020, people look at it as a sort of a year of pandemic. I look at it as a year of Indian science. Remember, when pandemic came, we did not have PPEs, all right, person protection equipment. We're importing from China. We did not have diagnostics. We're importing from China. We did not have therapeutics, basically, the remdesivirs of this world. We did not have vaccines. And today we have everything, basically. Our own vaccine, as we know. Covaxin is our sort of own vaccine. Our therapeutics, we created some of the cheapest therapeutics in the world. We are biggest suppliers of these to the world. So therefore, the strong base that has been built up right from time of independent investment that have been made, the vaccine did not come just like that by somebody snapped a finger. I mean, for example, when Krishna Ella created Covaxin, it was not that overnight he created it. It was deep investment that were done for a number of years that happened. And country is realizing the benefit of having sort of invested that. So if you look at all the revolutions that have taken place, whether it was green revolution in agriculture, whether it was white revolution, whether it was gray revolution, or even, I mean, if you look at Indian technology, for example, you know, we grew in denial-driven innovation region, okay? We didn't have supercomputer. We begged US. They did not give it. We said, thank you very much. We created Param supercomputers series. And then the same crave we were denied, they wanted to come and set us up. For example, you look at the defense, for example, we have developed diverse missiles, rocket systems, remotely piloted vehicles, light combat aircraft, etc., all on our own. Nuclear energy, we are again sort of denied the entire range of technologies. You know, so what is very important to realize is, you know, our Honorable Prime Minister talks about Atmanirbhar Bharat. Now we can see the importance of that Atmanirbhar sort of Bharat, because not that only these technologies will be denied, even civilian technologies are sort of denied. I've seen in my own long career how alpha olefin, butyl rubber, etc., they were all civilian technologies they were denied. And India has demonstrated that particular capacity. So I would say from the national security point of view, whether it is health, whether it is food, whether it is military security, et cetera, India has done sort of us proud in terms of creating these technologies. Can we do it better? Certainly. Can we put in more? Certainly. Can we move faster? Certainly. There is no question about it.
coming back to the big question, the climate change, you know, because you said that you're working on climate change. So I think in 1972, MIT had created this report. They had created this algorithm where they took all data of, you know, the pollution data and other global data. And they created a algorithm, and the prediction was that through that algorithm that around 2050, there will be a global catastrophic event because of a consumption, a senseless consumption with no conservation there in place. The head of KPMG Sustainability took the same report, the same algorithm, it's the world model. They fed in the recent data, and according to their analysis, it seems we are bang on target of, you know, not even 2050, possibly 2040 of a complete catastrophic climate problem because of a mindless consumption without any consumption. India obviously is going to be hit very, very bad because there was another report that out of the 50 polluted cities in the world, the most polluted cities in the world, 35 happens to be in India. You mentioned in the beginning of the conversation that the climate change is right there up in your mind, and that is what you are looking at. How do you solve this environmental threat that India is facing?
Yes, that's an excellent question. You know, our big challenge is the following. It is doing development without destruction. Okay. Now, how do you balance that out? That means you have to ensure that you move towards the future while maintaining growth. Okay. Because we don't have the luxury like the sort of rest of the world who grew and now they are developing problem. We are growing and therefore we require more energy. Okay, not less, basically. And therefore, while using that, how do we move transition to green technology and green energy? That is our challenge. Because we can't do without energy. We require several fold more energy than we do. And I'm very happy. I think our visionary prime minister has already set the ball rolling by giving the kind of targets and giving the promises in terms of when India will be net zero and so on and so forth. Targets have been set up for 2030. Etc. Not long distance where nobody's accountable, but short distance. And I'm very happy to see that we are right on target, very frankly, if you ask me. I've looked at the government policies. I've looked at the National Hydrogen Mission, for example, and so on and so forth. But equally importantly, I'm very much involved with now the biggest player in green hydrogen in the country, and that is Reliance. I've been on the board of Reliance from 2007. Basically long time. And I've been chairman of their new energy council, as it is called, with seven experts that Mukesh Ambani, the chairman, has created. And he has set himself a heavy target in terms of multi-billion dollar investments and creating gigafactories, end-to-end integration. And when I say integration, it is not getting solar panels from China, by the way. It is starting with sand, converting into silicon, creating silicon vapors, all the systems, creating solar panels and electricity therefrom, and then splitting water by using that electricity to create green hydrogen. And the kind of targets he has set up are sort of phenomenal. You know what are the targets? 111. Nobody in the world has put it up. You know what is 111? 1 kilogram of green hydrogen for $1 within 1 decade. Can you just imagine? It is sort of heady. And people wonder whether you will be able to do that. But it's the same gentleman who gave 4 rupees per GB and voice free and had 500 million customers sort of using it. So it is like a geofication, if you like. That means affordable excellence, getting more from less for more and more people for a billion people. Not only that, if you go to Asia Economic Dialogue that was held in February, and that is on the web, and I can send you the link. There is a conversation between me and him in the opening session, by the way, where he actually talks about in a very interesting way. You know, he has a way of simplifying. He talks about, look, what is the raw material? Sun is there, water is there. We can create hydrogen. What was missing was affordable technology. Now we have the affordable technology. So why can't we create that? And he projects that within 20 years' time, India will be able to export $500 billion worth new energy to the rest of the world. Now, when he says something, you have to seriously think about it. So I think the main point I'm trying to make here is that from the government policy standpoint, et cetera, there are sort of aggressive thinking that is going on. I love the, just now, the Niti Aayog has put together the new document facilitating sort of creation of new technologies, et cetera, et cetera. And also from corporate world, there are sort of aspirational goals of this kind of becoming world leader. Because see, the basic issue is that as far as India is concerned, what does it specialize? Affordable excellence. 10x, 10 times better, 10 times cheaper. That is our specialty, isn't it? So creating affordable green hydrogen at the lowest cost of the highest quality, which we can export, is the target that has been sort of set up. And like we have done in other cases, we should be able to do that. That's the second point. The third point is that if you look at the national laboratory systems, the corporates and others, etc., we are ready with technologies. I don't know how many of you will know that as far as fuel cells are concerned, because fuel cells are the ones who generate electricity by using a sort of hydrogen. And for that, you require what are called as fuel cells, proton exchange membrane-based fuel cells. Now, these are all imported technologies. We said no. When I created the New Millennium Indian Technology Leadership Initiative, Leadership in Capital World, in 2000. In 2002, when nobody talked about hydrogen, we went onto the program of fuel cell. And what is the benefit today? KPIT Technologies, National Chemical Laboratory, Central Electrochemical Research Institute has created our own indigenous fuel cell, which is doing now thousands of kilometers. The buses are running right away. So we'll have our own technology, which will be even sort of exportable because it belongs to the affordable excellence class. So some in substance is, whether it is talent, whether it is technology, we must have trust in our ability sort of to deal with this problem. That's the basic issue.
Thank you, sir. Really, really appreciate you taking time, being part of the podcast, sharing your insights, and you're doing so many awesome things. You know, I wish our future generation shares, you know, your strength, your curiosity, the dedication of bringing science, technology, and innovation to the forefront. I had a lovely time chatting with you, and I can feel your energy and enthusiasm. You're still like a child, you know. And your advice to the youngster. Yeah. Yes.
So they are called five Mashelkar mantras. All right. And any interview that I give, any lecture that I give, I don't make sure that I give these five. So very quickly, let me tell you what are those five Mashelkar mantras for my young generation, which will determine our future. The very first is aspirations are your possibilities. So keep them high. Okay? If you aim at Everest, at least you will reach Kanchenjunga. But if you aim at Kanchenjunga, you will be where you are. Okay? So that is first. The second is, particularly for the young generation, you know, they like instant coffee, they want instant success. I'm sorry. It is hard work. There is no substitute to hard work. I'll be turning 80 now on 1st January, but I can tell you I'm doing 24/7, day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, and I'll do till the end of my life. The only suggestion to the my young friends is work hard in silence, let success make all the noise. The third one is my three P's, purpose, perseverance, and passion. You have to have a big purpose, not only for yourself, the North Star, as we say, but for our society, for our nation, and perseverance. Winners are never quitters, quitters are never winners. It is always too early to give up, and do it with passion. That's the third one. The fourth is doors. You keep on knocking on the doors of opportunity. They don't open, all right? You create your own doors. Like I did when I was at NCL, I did not get my equipment, I said, forget about it. I created my own door and went into modeling and simulation, winning the Bhatnagar Prize. Had I waited just like that because I'm not getting an equipment, what would happen? And the last one, please remember, there's no limit to human endurance. There's no limit to human achievement. There's no limit to human imagination, excepting the limit you put on yourself. And therefore, whatever you achieve, basically, remember, the ladder of excellence is limitless, all right? And therefore, whatever you achieve, I would simply say, you have to say to yourself, my best is yet to come. So every day in the morning, my last message is, get up in the morning, say my best is yet to come. Maybe today is the day. And my best is yet to come, not just for me, but for my society, for my nation. And keep on doing it, whether you are 18, like young people, or like 80, which I will be, till the last day, you have to do that. And if all Indians do it, 1.4 billion Indians do that every day, what a great nation we'll have. Right in the cone of nations, we'll occupy the space which we know we are always.
Thank you, sir, for taking time and being part of the Humble Podcast. It was a completely enriching and learning experience for me, especially these five profound advice for everyone. You know, I take each of them and I hope that my listeners do that, you know, because if they do that, they take that and leverage it for themselves, they can create better businesses and also become better human beings, you know, because I think we always set limitations. And I guess when we go beyond that, we become more. And I guess you are a living example for that, you know, somebody who's come from an abject poverty to, you know, becoming India's most eminent scientist and being part of some of the most transformational changes here in India. You are a living example of that. I think your journey is just beginning, you know, because you have taken the two biggest challenge of what India faces, you know, climate change and accelerated inclusive growth. And I'm sure through you, your partnership with Reliance and, you know, looking at green hydrogen, you will be creating a huge transformation over there. And also through the accelerated inclusive growth, you know, through the tech, democratizing it, you know, for leveraging for education. I wish you the very best. Please keep on doing what you're doing, because we need more leaders, such as yourself, who are pushing the boundaries of possibilities and working on creating a better India. So really appreciate you taking time being part of the podcast. To my listeners, if you like what you see and hear, then please press the subscribe button. Until next time, see you guys. Bye-bye. Thank you, sir. Really appreciate this.